is number 8 in terms of job growth. They're 5.1% in unemployment. And just yesterday, the state of Oregon released their job figures for January. Here was the quote. Bend, Corvallis, Portland, Salem, and the North Coast are adding jobs as fast as these regions ever have in the past 40 years. So certainly the state of Oregon has made a huge comeback. What about Portland Metro? Well, Forbes ranked Portland as the third best business climate in the nation. Portland Metro unemployment now is down to 4.9%, and we've added 39,000 jobs. 39,000 jobs over the last year. Just, I can't remember the last time we've added that many jobs in Portland Metro. So truly an amazing year. We added jobs at the rate of 3.5%, and the nation saw job growth closer to 2%. This is the seventh year of recovery.
We're now 86,000 jobs higher than we were at the depths of the recession. Now, the thing about these jobs is that they're higher paying jobs. If you look at this chart, it shows you where the salaries are for the new jobs that we've been adding. And a lot of people drive around and they say, how can people afford all these new apartments? And when Patrick shows you some of the rents here, the new apartments, you'll be pretty amazed. But the reason is that these people, they're making good money. And of the tech jobs in the U.S., they have grown at about 30%, but in Portland, they've grown about 82%. So we're getting a lot of jobs for people who are making good salaries. We've also had a number of branch offices come here and expand. They're not headquarters companies, but places like Airbnb and eBay and Salesforce.com and Under Armour and Aruba Networks. And then we also have Urban Airship. Now, most of the job growth has been in companies 20 people and under, and we really haven't seen the job growth in major companies. We have had the loss of a couple major companies or job cuts at major companies. ESCO, in particular, was a big one, impacted by some of the things going on in the oil and energy industry. And we also had the loss of the headquarters of Precision Cast Parts and Standard Insurance. But I think the biggest change in 2015 was that Portland is getting respect. Portland is on the radar all of a sudden. Now, we're definitely not a big superheated gateway city like San Francisco or LA or New York or Chicago, but Portland is now one of the strong kind of secondary markets and is recognized as a healthy economy. I think we're in the other similar metropolitan areas include Charlotte and Austin and Denver and San Diego and San Antonio. So you're getting a lot of money that's coming into Portland, a lot of out-of-town money. And I'll be talking that more shortly. The third kind of major influence that I think has a big impact on the apartment market is home ownership. And this is a ratio I watch pretty closely. Home ownership can result in a huge amount of demand without any job growth or population growth. So I watch those ratios closely. Basically, at the peak of the economy before the crash, we were at 69%, and we're now closer to 63%. So huge swing and huge amount of demand for apartments because of that swing. But the Census Bureau comes out with these figures, and we're still seeing a slight dip here in the different regions. In the U.S., it's basically flat. It's ticked down a little bit. But what's interesting is in the West Coast, it's actually the ratio of home ownership has ticked up a little bit. So to me, that's something I want to watch closely because that's a number. If it bottoms out and moves back up, it will have a big implication for the apartment market. So I mentioned there are four different things that we watch kind of closely on the apartment market to gauge where we are. Interest rates, employment, and home ownership. The fourth one would be apartment construction. There's probably no one that has a better handle on what's going on with apartment construction. He writes a report that has probably the most detailed information on what's in the pipeline. And at this time, I'd like to turn it over to Patrick Barry.
Thank you. So I'm going to talk briefly here about apartment construction, rents, and vacancies. I'm going to start off with this chart from JLL. I think this chart sums up what's happened, kind of how we got to where we are today with the housing market the best. For 20 years, we averaged 13,000 units. That includes multifamily and single family across the Portland metro. From 95 to 2007, we were well above 13,000. From 2008 to 2015, we've averaged right about 7,000. So all that area below the line is the shortage of housing that we have right now. 2015 shows about 13,000, so we're back to about average, but we're not really making up any ground. This next slide just confirms the previous one. This shows how many housing units we need per person of population growth. So we need about 0.4 housing units per person that we gain in the Portland metro area. From 2000 to 2005, we were 10,000 people over, 10,000 units over. From 2006 to today, we're 22,000 under. So really, we're about 12,000 in the hole on units. Apartment construction has remained strong in Portland. 2015 saw about 6,700 permits for new units. This is equal to about 2014. By no means is it a record-setting pace, but it's well above where we were in 2008 and 2009. New construction is meeting new demand, but we're not really digging in to the hole that we've dug ourselves on vacancies. And I know this might surprise some people. You drive around, you see tons of construction, you think to yourself, there's no way that we're not overbuilding. And sometimes I do agree. But here are my thoughts on this. To me, this is your typical urban infill project. It's low-rise, urban, high-density, built up to the lot lines, lots of neighbors nearby. The neighbors are angry because of the noise, the proximity to their property. Parking, there might be a newspaper article, might be a community meeting, but at the end of the day, you have 25 units. And this is happening everywhere. This is probably smaller than most projects, but it's not that atypical. You go out to the suburbs, you have a large piece of vacant land, you have a similar amount of headache, you have neighbors, you have people who aren't unhappy about the development, but at the end of the day, you have 300 units. And there's not many of the 300-unit properties going on, but there's countless properties like this going on. Highly visible, impact everyone's daily life. No surprise here. Most of the apartment activity is happening in Multnomah County, mostly close in, about two-thirds of it. Another 15% is happening in Washington County, another 15% in Clark County, and then Clackamas County and East County rounded out. So everyone knows about the close-in construction, but this is kind of a new trend that we've seen. This is a chart produced by an architect who runs the website called Next Portland. And on the far left, you'll see the completed projects out past 205. The next, you'll see the ones under construction. And then next, you'll see the ones in for early assistance for the design commission. As you can see, activity is definitely increasing. And I think this is going to be a new trend as we see low vacancy rates, we see rents increasing, and when you go out past 205, the land gets much, much cheaper, which makes these projects much more viable. So the reasons apartment construction is strong, there's kind of the usual suspects here. Low vacancies, increasing rents, strong economy, record-setting apartment values, and a strong appetite from investors. But probably one of the biggest reasons is there's big margins right now between value of these apartments completed and the cost of building them. And I think any developer in here can tell you that there's a healthy margin and a good incentive to go out there and build. So from fall 2015, Multifamily Northwest has us at a 2.9% vacancy rate, a very, very healthy vacancy rate. So despite all the new construction over the past 2 years, we're not only at a low vacancy rate, but we're declining. We're down 100 basis points from the previous year. And this survey includes 20 submarkets. Every submarket's below 4%. 12 submarkets are below 3%, with the lowest being Troutdale, Gresham, and Fairview at under 2%. Highest vacancies are in downtown Portland and Lake Oswego. When you look at the four submarkets that are most impacted by the construction, we're still at just 3.5%. I mean, still very, very low rates. And when you look at unit types, well, really, there's no oversupply at all. Studios show the highest rents, highest vacancy is about 4.2%, but every other unit type is below 3%. So despite all the new construction, everything that's gone in the past 2 years, it clearly remains a landlord's market. I think sometimes Portlanders get so focused on what's happening here that we forget what's happening on a national scale. This is a chart produced by CoStar, and it's actually shown rent has decreased across the nation, especially in the second half of 2015. And the markets most affected, when you dig a little deeper into the article, there's San Francisco, San Jose, Seattle, Denver. These are often towns that are coupled with Portland when we talk about cities on a national scale. You dig a little deeper into it, you see it's mostly units that were built after 2010 that are impacted. But at the end of the day, rents were still up 6% last year across the nation. But the second half definitely showed slowing increases or some declines. So what about Portland? Axiometrics came out with their data just for the fourth quarter 2015, and it shows Portland rent growth up 12%. That's the top in the nation. That's the second quarter in a row that we've topped the charts. Multifamily Northwest shows a little bit lower at about 9%. Rents went up from $1.22 to $1.33 over 12 months. Keep in mind, these rent increases are based on turnover rents and are not necessarily income. We typically see about 4 to 6% increase in income over the past 12 months. And as Mark mentioned, I want to point out a few apartments that are renting right now. I just went on Craigslist yesterday and pulled these up. $2,300 for a new luxury downtown apartment. You got $1,950 for kind of a low-rise apartment over by the Lloyd Center. But with that, you have $2,900 in free rent. Or if you want to go down into Northwest Portland, you're paying $1,350 for an upgraded one-bedroom unit. This is a graph here produced by Jerry Johnson at Johnson Economics, and it goes through the rent increases across the city, ranging anywhere from 20% up to 70% in North Portland. And when you compare this to wage growth, you can see why there are some angry residents. Some feel that landlords have it a little too good and are being a little too greedy. So the issue of strong apartment rents is clearly a hot topic among investors, owners, property managers, brokers, but it's also become a political hot potato, and there's increasing pressure on politicians to do something, anything. In the fall, Portland enacted a 90-day notice for rent increases and no-cause evictions, and now the state of Oregon's considering even more tight restrictions. Some of the rules they're considering are no rent increases during the first month of a year-to-year lease, 90-day notice on any rent increases and no-cause evictions, inclusionary zoning, paying the relocation costs for no-cause evictions, and rent control. I don't expect any of this to go away anytime soon until there's some relief for these renters, because when you compare renters and landlords, there's sure a lot more renters than landlords out there. Next, I'll turn it back over to Mark to continue on.
Great. Thank you, Patrick. Okay, the next thing I'd like to talk about is what's happening with apartment sales. How many brokers are in this room? Okay, so a lot of brokers. There are really two ways of looking at apartment sales. One is by number of transactions, and another is by dollar volume. In looking at year-to-date 2016, it's just a little too early to kind of get some sense of where the market's going, but there have been about 35 sales and somewhere around $200 million in sales volume. So it's a little slower than last year, but it's way too early to really come to grips with any kind of trends. But what about 2015? Well, 2015 had more transactions than we have ever seen in the Portland area. There were 320 apartment sales last year. And this is in comparison with 230 sales last or the year before. So basically, the volume was up just about 40%. But what about the sales? What about the sales volume, dollar sales volume? Well, as I'll be discussing shortly, apartment values have increased quite a bit. And we had about a 50% increase in apartment sales volume this last year. We went from 1.6 billion in 2014 to 2.4 billion in sales. So why are apartment sales so strong? Well, one of them is, I mentioned Portland is getting some respect as a place for investors. There are also many new apartments built with the intention of selling them, basically merchant builders. We've also had apartment values at record highs. So you've had people that, for them, the window is wide open to get out. If you're a seller thinking about getting out, values have never been higher. If you're on the fence, this is probably a good time to do it. Also, if you have an estate issue with the next generation where you need cash to kind of take care of the beneficiaries, this is a good time to do it. Also, I think if you have some properties in your portfolio maybe that aren't working out or that you're struggling with, it's also a lot of people are getting out of those. And finally, you've had a lot of long-time owners with a very low basis. They've had self-management, and they're just kind of worn out. They see that record highs and figure that, gee, they're going to be getting out before too long anyway, and this is probably the time to do it. And the final reason, as Patrick mentioned, is that there's a big margin between apartment values and construction costs. And we do quite a few appraisals of proposed projects, particularly in the maybe 8 to 10 to up to maybe 30 or 40, 50 units. And quite frankly, I'll see the costs, and then we run through all the cost figures and all the books and go through developers' cost figures. And even if you add a healthy profit margin, I'm a little surprised that there's such a gap between cost and value. So what about marketing time? In the last couple years, you can see on the left axis is the number of months, and on the lower axis is the year. But you can see that there's been quite a drop in marketing time, where now it averages about 3 months. And so what about apartment sales in terms of percent of the listing price or asking price? Basically, it's now at 99%. So it shows me that very strong demand, a lot of activity, and clearly a seller's market. So what about values? Before I talk about values in Portland Metro, let's talk about values nationally. Now, apartments have been the darling of the investment community. If you compare apartments nationally versus commercial properties nationally, you can see that apartments have taken a run-up quite a bit more than commercial properties. What about Portland Metro? Well, here we are in a market with increasing rents, low vacancies, low interest rates, strong job growths, and apartments being the darling of the investment community. And this has been an obvious formula for value increases. In 2015, quite frankly, I've never seen anything like it. And as an appraiser, I really struggled because I wanted to make sure I used all current sales because the market was so strong this last year. Now, the apartment market moved up a little bit. It was basically flat from 2008 to 2013. It moved up a little bit in 2014, but it took a huge leap in 2015, like nothing I've ever seen. So this chart takes every single sale of every single apartment and breaks it down to the median price per square foot. And my figures show that the median price per square foot went from about $100 in 2014 to about $125 in 2015. So I would say values increased maybe a low side of 15% and a maximum of maybe 25%. But there's something else on this chart that is just a little disturbing. I took all the sales for 2016, and basically there are about 35 of them. Again, broke them down to the median price per square foot. And all of a sudden, we had a slight dip for 2016. So what's going on? So what I did was I took all the same sales, but used a little different criteria. And that was, rather than the median price per square foot, the median price per square foot on a semi-annual basis. And you can see here, in the first half of 2015, it looks like values were at their highest. They came down a little bit in the second half of 2015. And based on the sales that we have for 2016, it looks like they've come back a little bit. So if you believe these figures and you think there's big enough sample, what it is telling us is that of the run-up in values we've had the last year, we've given back maybe two-thirds of that. Is that true? Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. But it will certainly vary by the different submarkets. So let's take a look at a couple other indicators. One would be cap rates. What's happened with cap rates? Well, basically, we had the same trend in cap rates. And that's that cap rates kind of bottom with their lowest the first half of 2015. They moved up a little bit in the second half of 2015. And they're a little higher so far for year-to-date 2016. So what it does is kind of validates what I was talking about on the price per square foot. So what about the average price per unit? Well, again, we see some slight softening there. So it tells me that maybe the market has kind of peaked out and we might have hit a top there. So it just so happens that here's some information, kind of takes Portland Metro, which summarizes this data. Here we show the cap rates kind of gradually moving up. Price per square foot has moved down a little bit, and price per unit has moved down a little bit. So I work a lot of different markets. And just for the heck of it, I tried looking at, some of the suburban county. I'm sorry, back one. I tried looking at some of the urban counties, and you can see here that the urban counties urban apartments are showing some of the same trends. And that's that it looks like it kind of peaked out in the first half of the year and has softened up just a little bit in the second half. There's another market, and that is the suburban apartments. And I happen to be working some properties, so I have these charts readily available. But the suburban apartments, those 1960, 1980 built apartments, they've been, looks like it's held up a little stronger, and it's pretty much the same values in 2016 as the second half of 2015. So I am a believer in the theory of reversion to the mean. And reversion to the mean basically tells us, here's to define it. Reversion to the mean is the statistical phenomena stating that the greater the deviation of a random variate from its mean, the greater probability that the next measure variate will deviate far less. In other words, an extreme event is likely to be followed by a less extreme event. And that's exactly what we saw, I think, in apartment values in 2015. We have never seen a jump like that. So what we might have gotten a little bit ahead of ourselves there. And my guess is that, the data tells us that it's pulled back just a little bit from those kind of crazy values and unbelievable increases that we saw in 2015. Okay, I'd like to just, I went through the price per unit and also the price per square foot, but basically you're seeing the same trend here that if you take a trend line or least squares or reversion, it looks like we're maybe getting just a little bit ahead of ourselves there. Okay, I'd like to go through just a couple sales. Now, I normally would not include a 100 unit that is part of a $1 billion sale, but this is Blackstone, and Blackstone, I had to do a little internet search here, but they manage $4.5 trillion in assets. And I'm not sure how much even a trillion is. What is that, $1,000 billion? But this is a huge outfit, and here they are investing in Portland. And as I'll be discussing shortly, there's a lot of money coming into Portland, this kind of stuff, but also a lot of smaller properties. I've gone through a couple sales here, fairly typical kind of sales that have happened just recently. This is being built by kind of a well-known developer who's a merchant builder, built a lot of properties for sale, and is selling most of his properties. So it's selling at about $214,000 a unit. The next one is a Northwest Portland apartment, just recently closed, somewhere about 166,000 units. This is unreinforced masonry, which I'll be discussing shortly. A recent Forest Grove sale at about 73,000 units, and the 73,000 seems to be about the bottom of the market. Here's a property in West Lynn. Again, kind of a bread and butter property, but selling for 87,000 unit. And finally, there's one in Milwaukee that just closed at about 107,000 unit. And anybody that's been in the apartment market, if you look back a year or two, that these are values and sales prices we never would have dreamed of. So, who are the buyers and who are the sellers? If you look at all the major buyers, and if you do a Google research on these companies, you're going to see that most of them are financial institutions that get money from many individual investors, many like you and me, and pool it. But others have different sources of funds. Certainly NFN has been very active and a local company. Most of these are not local companies. So we get a lot of money coming from out of town. So these are the major buyers. Where's the smart money? Is it the buyers or the sellers? So let's look at who the sellers are. We have Holland. Now, Holland is a very well-regarded company. They were big sellers before the crash. They were big buyers at the bottom, but now they have been the biggest sellers. They've also been buyers, and then you've got Fowler, you know, major company on the West Coast. You've got Guardian, who's local, and then a lot of these are other institutional companies that solicit money from people like you and me. Okay, I mentioned soliciting money from people like you and me. Let's talk about that. Okay, just for the heck of it, I went to my stock brokerage account, and I wanted to pick quickly one of the biggest buyers of apartments, so Invesco. And this was as of the last day or two of February. So it's pretty current. So they have bought about 150 million in apartments. What time does the stock market close?
1 o'clock.
1 o'clock. Okay, so we're probably too late. But anyone tomorrow can go down there and buy stock in Invesco or many of these other companies, and you can be one of the owners of apartments in Portland. The thing is, there's a lot of money that these people have because you and I were getting, there's no yield on our money markets or CDs or in the bond market. So people are putting in some of these companies, but they might be reaching a little too high. And this just happens to be one I pick randomly, but you can see that they're year-to-date 2016, they're down about 8%. Their return is 0.4%, basically the dividend. And the management fee is 2%. And that's not 2% of income, that's 2% of assets. So you have a lot of this money chasing product, but it's fairly high fee money, and they've had a major impact on the apartment market. I just, for the heck of it, looked at my stock account while I was at it, and the money markets I have are 0.0% to 0.01%. So if you put $1 million in the bank, you're going to get $100 and not enough to take your spouse out to dinner and get a good bottle of wine. The CD is 0.75%, and five-year CD about 1.7%, and a AAA 10-year bond about 3%. So with rates being so low, you've had people reaching for other places to go to get yield, and one of them has been in the publicly traded market, which has fueled the real estate market across the nation, including Portland. Okay, what about the expense side? Now, it's been a fairly stable expense environment. Property taxes, no great surprises, somewhere in that maybe 1 to 4% range increases. I think what we're finding is tremendous inequities in the Oregon property tax system because of the property tax limitation measure. And it's particularly true in some of the strong urban areas like North Portland, where you get the same value and they may be paying half as much in property taxes. Unfortunately, East County has gotten some ugly surprises on increases in property taxes because of some of the issues with compression. Utilities continue to move up, and quite frankly, I see so many operating statements, and it's not unusual to see the total utilities, water, sewer, garbage, up to over $100 per unit per month. Repair and maintenance has actually been under control, mainly because tenants are not moving as much. And so all in all, the expense side has been pretty stable. Now, before I get into some thoughts, kind of where the market's going in 2016, I'd just like to throw out some random thoughts here and kind of things I see going on in the market. One of them is value added. And everybody that's buying an apartment thinks they're getting a deal, the rents are too low, that it's poorly managed, and that they can move it up, and that this thing, they could reposition it to make a much more desirable investment. This is one we happen to, kind of a smaller property, but you know, a lot of people like the old brick court. Basically, this was before and this was after. They went in and unfortunately, everyone got evicted. They put in all new windows, new roof, detailed out the insides. They paid $95 a unit, and I think put about $25,000 a unit into the property. And a typical value might be, say, $150 or $160 a unit afterwards. So pretty strong margin there. And you get a lot of people kind of working this market. Now, I just looked at the appraisals we've done, kind of picked the last 50 or so, and maybe over half of them are were sales and mostly kind of value added. This is a typical property where someone has gone in and detailed it out. And you have an old 60s, average quality apartment. They've gone in and put the laminate wood floors, new cabinets, microwave, new appliances, two-tone, three-tone paint, new front door, and really done it right, all new siding. But so you're getting lots of this, and basically, I checked the rents this last week, and they're almost $1,300 for a 500 square foot one bedroom. Another trend we're seeing are the micro units, and it's kind of a new phenomena. The good thing about the micro units is that it allows people to get into the urban area at a fairly low price. And I try to go on tours when some of these properties open, and believe me, some of those units, I mean, you don't want to have more than one or two friends over because there's no place to put them. And keep in mind, a typical garage is about 10 by 20, so these are tight units. Another big issue is the seismic retrofit. Who saw that article in the New Yorker? Okay, so you guys are up to speed. Okay, the New Yorker, well-regarded national publication, you know, good research, solid information, and well-respected. They came out with this article talking about the big one in the Northwest. Well, basically, it was a little alarming. I think pretty good science. They quoted all the right people, and no one is complaining or questioning some of their scientific evidence. But what it did was it made people nervous. And right around the same time, do anybody remember that windstorm in 2014? Well, it blew the cornice off this building, the Zanabe Court in Northwest. And you can see the damage. We also have the city of Portland, which has the inventory of all the unreinforced masonry buildings. There are about 2,000 of them. And so there's a movement to force people to seismically upgrade these units. It's broken into four categories. First, it would be hospitals, schools, and fire departments, and then high rises, and then apartments like we saw, and then smaller properties. But if you look at the costs, you're talking some big numbers. And so this has had an impact on the due diligence and the scrutiny and the marketing of some of these type of properties. I've tried to look at these unreinforced masonry buildings pretty closely in our travels, to see what kind of discount. And quite frankly, the market's so strong, I think, I'm not sure it's really looking at this issue. But I think if you're going to be forced to retrofit a building, you're looking at costs that the figures I see are somewhere around $30 a foot, maybe too high or too low. So, okay, another issue I've seen in the market is dynamic pricing. And I'd never heard of dynamic pricing, but they price apartments like they do airline tickets, where it might vary during the day or it might vary during the week or based on the number of vacancies. So that's kind of a new thing. We're seeing it a few properties. Another thing I'm seeing in the apartment market is people are asking, where's the next hot neighborhood? And so everyone knows that the area from the river out to 39th or Cesar Chavez is picked over and values are high. But people are now starting to move out from between 82nd and 39th and going out to the Monte Villa or the Beaumont or Cully or Rose or Lentz. So you're getting all of a sudden a lot more activity in those neighborhoods. And they're really pretty nice neighborhoods, platted lots and sidewalks and, you know, brew pubs and arterials. And I think what happened on Division caught a lot of people off guard and felt they kind of missed the boat on that one. And once you get out past 82nd and out past the 205, it's kind of a different world in terms of the arterials and the sidewalks and services. So these areas are getting picked over, a lot of sales at pretty high prices in these neighborhoods. A couple other things is that Airbnb, you know, it's getting a lot of press. I've only seen, like in the last 2 years, maybe one or two properties that might have one or two units that are doing Airbnb. So I don't think it's had any impact from what I can see on the rental market in terms of taking supply out of the pipeline. Another issue I'm seeing is brokers are having a hard time on pricing. And I'm glad they're not the only ones, because certainly appraisers are too, because the market's been so strong. And so what we're seeing a little bit of is properties going to market where there's no pricing and they just kind of let some of the bids come in. You know, brokers, there have been many instances where a property is listed and all of a sudden you're getting offers at more than list. So these are some of the trends, kind of random trends I'm seeing in the market. What about the balance of 2016? Where are we going? Well, I've spoken to this group a number of times, and believe me, I've looked back at some of the forecasts or trends and I have been humbled. And the reason is no one expected the Portland to be so strong in terms of values and rents and job growth and Portland getting recognized. So I guess I'm just a little gun shy to stick my neck out there too much, but I just want to throw out a couple things. Interest rates. People have been crying wolf for a long time. And who knows where interest rates go? And this is a little bit dated, but Connerly, you know, is pretty well regarded. He sees Portland and he's tapped in with Forbes. And so basically his figures show about 200 basis points over a 2 or 3 year period. So you go back to that chart, is he right or is he wrong? Who knows? And you can get lots of people with different opinions. But if you figure that there's a relationship between cap rates and interest rates, and you got that spread, it tells us that it could have some impact there. Another thing is employment. Now, the employment market, we are firing on all cylinders. And I think so highly of Josh Lerner and the state of Oregon and what they do with their figures. And they put out a lot of emails each week, and I try to read them all. But you know, it's exceptionally strong, and it certainly shows the job figures that just came out yesterday. So we are at record high, unprecedented. You know, one of the leading indicators would be unemployment claims. And based on these figures, it doesn't, you know, it's one of the leading indicators, but there's really doesn't look like there's a slowdown here. The state of Oregon is forecasting 2.7% for the state in job growth. Now that would, and keep in mind, it was 3.5% last year. So that would translate into about 30,000 jobs. And, you know, 30,000 jobs, I mean, I think we would take it in a heartbeat because that's a strong economy and probably higher job growth than we've done in, you know, 90% of the years in the last 20 years or so. The other ratio that I want to watch closely is home ownership. Where are we going? Well, who knows? But I want to watch these figures closely. And that last uptick for the fourth quarter in the west part of the U.S. showed that maybe that's flattening out. And I know that they talk a lot about the millennials and the millennials renting the houses and they don't want the burden and all that. But sooner or later, the millennials start to have a wife and a spouse and a husband and children. And all of a sudden, some of their goals change. And I happen to have a couple of millennials for children. And, you know, I kind of know their friends and, you know, they're buying houses. So I think this is something we want to watch closely. The previous slide was a couple PhDs that their thought was it would move up a little bit. This is another person who kind of thinks that this ratio is going to move down. And the main reason is because of the immigrants coming in. So, okay, so the final thing is apartment construction. Apartment construction is not as hard to get a handle on. Patrick has detailed figures, but he's talking about 9,000 units are under construction right now. And of course, you get a lead time with those coming on. And we add up and spent a lot of time getting the figures in the pipeline. And our figures show there are about 21,000. Now, some of those will fall out of bed and won't come to fruition. Others may emerge. But and these numbers haven't changed that much over recent years. But what it tells us, there's a lot in the pipeline, there's a lot of interest, and we could have a fair amount of supply coming on, which would probably be good just to get the market a little more in balance and to maybe deal with some of the rental issues that we've had in the market. In conclusion, I think we all got to ask, where are we in the cycle? So once you come to an answer, the next question is, how long are we going to be there, and what's the next phase? I think if you kind of look at some of the things I mentioned today, you can kind of come to your own conclusions. We could be maybe in the thrill and euphoria stage. I've shown that there's been a slight downturn in some of the value indicators, which, who knows whether that's an incident or a trend. And with the economy being so strong here, maybe I got the wrong phase, but maybe we're going to be there a while. But I would say that the market has moved up so fast that there could be some risk if you were a buyer in the last year or so. I think the big wild card is how many units will get built, what's going to happen with the home ownership rate. Also, we're in a cyclical industry. And when will we return to the mean? And the other question we got to ask, is this time different? Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. I think some of the kind of positive things we have going is that strong local economy, doesn't seem to be any break in the action. Low vacancies, but in 45 days, we're going to have the new figures for multifamily Northwest. And I'll be very interested in seeing those. We got low interest rates. We've had declining home ownership, which now seems to be a little more flattening out. We've had tremendous momentum here in the market. And every broker in here knows that this is a seller's market and that you've got plenty of buyers and it's hard finding the sellers. But there's also a repositioning and a redefining of Portland. I think on the weak side is that it's been a tough 60 days for the financial markets and for the stock market and some of the things going on. We also have a very strong dollar, which is great if you're traveling overseas, but it's not so good if you're exporting. We also have interest rates, which will they be increasing? We have high apartment construction. We have turmoil in the energy markets. Values, have they peaked? And certainly that's an issue. Also, the rent versus buy equation. And when Patrick shows me those rents there in some of these new buildings, you do a little quick math and, you know, there's some other options in terms of the ownership. And finally, when is the next recession? My own thoughts is that 2015 was without a doubt the best year we have ever seen in my career in the apartment market. I, quite frankly, I would be surprised if in my career, even lifetime, we're ever going to see anything as good as it got in 2015. My guess is that we're going to have strong momentum in 2016, but I haven't seen any sign of sort of a major softening, but I wouldn't be surprised to see a slight uptick in vacancies, moderate rental increases, a more balance between landlords and tenants, and I think we're going to see some stabilization of apartment values. We're not going to see the run-up that we saw the last 12 months, and really the figures from the last figures I showed early seem to confirm that. I think we're going to continue to be in the sweet spot in the market, in the real estate cycle. I think we're going to get pretty good fundamentals in 2016, but I think we're going to see a gradual shift to a landlord's market and away from a amazing seller's market to a market that is a little more in balance in 2016 and 2017. So that's kind of how I see things going on in the apartment market, and that's about it in terms of my presentation.
Anyone have any questions for Patrick?
You know, I'll be honest with you. I'm not sure I'm really have the mindset or tools to deal with that issue. I tend to be an appraiser and more react to facts, but I guess I don't really have an opinion, haven't even thought about, but I probably ought to. So. You know, we do keep an eye on that, and I think when the recession hit so hard, so many people were buying those houses because they were so cheap, and we've got a lot of, a lot of rental houses out there. I think there have been some upgrades, and that market's been so strong, and that could be, you know, another source of people that are selling them to homeowners, but I don't kind of follow that market in any kind of detail. You know, my sense is that brokers are out there stirring the pot, and that there many of the sales, actually it was more a pocket listing, and they were in conversations, and in the broker's conversations with the owner, the owner wasn't aware values were so high that the owner would bring them a buyer, and all of a sudden they'd come to terms. So, I see that property just hit the market yesterday, like 95 a unit for one bedrooms. I'm not seeing a lot that's, you know, out there in terms of listings, but I think there's a lot more available out there. With the value added, such a big gap between your final value with the improvements and the current value, that it's run up the values of the existing property just because you've got some margins there between value after and value as is. It's a pretty new phenomena. And I think that they just loosened up the tent camping. I think it's been, in the last 45 days. I have a feeling that's going to be a short-term phenomena and that they're going to kind of deal with that because it's clearly caused some problems in certain neighborhoods and for certain properties because of the litter and the, you know, just things going on. And so, I have not seen anything, but I don't think that that's going to, I've heard of some people that are upset, but I haven't heard anything in terms of how that might impact investors. I think it's going to be a short-term phenomena.
We've got to use the mic. Oh, okay. I just wondered with the increases in rental cost, I'm assuming that that led to higher turnover and then some people ending up out of the housing market, moving in with family or whatever. Did you track those numbers or is there a way to even track that? I'm trying to figure out what the effect of the rental increase was versus looking at what the state and the city are trying to do to control that.
Yeah, I don't follow those figures closely, but we do lots of properties where, for better or worse, everyone got their eviction notice. And it's been my impression that, in particular on the east side, that people haven't had any choice, so they got to go to the other side of 82nd, where rents are quite a bit cheaper. And so I don't have good numbers on that, but that's kind of my sense of what's going on.
Mark, in your apartment report, there's different categories under construction and planned. Can you tell us how you identify all of the planned projects and how those might change over time as the project concepts change?
Do you want to take? Yeah, I can say this, it's a huge job and it changes daily. And they come and they go, but there are actually many website sources that have everything in the planning stage. And if you know what's in the planning stage, you can just go to the website and figure out kind of what's what. If they spent that much money, you know, it looks like it's going to be a serious project.
Hi, Mark, I have a question. You said you're expecting an uptick in vacancies or a little one next year. Do you see a flattening out in pricing? Because you said we're 12,000 units short still in the metro area, but can we really absorb 12,000 more units? And they're all at the same price point, right, for the renters?
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, at some point, I just feel like the market used to be more balanced because you had low-end units and high-end units. Whereas now all the units, all the rehabs are coming out at $2 to $3 a foot.
Yeah.
So where do you forecast that? I mean, it seems like there's
got
to be a flattening.
I tend to work a lot of B and C stuff and it's kind of shy away from that. But my sense is that that market, you know, there's so much inventory and so much coming on. And so I try to talk closely to the property managers that are running those and kind of get accurate figures on absorption. I also, occasionally we do appraisals in some of these so we get all the numbers. My sense is things have been pretty good. You know, it's tough in the winter, so there were lots of concessions and they use that as a marketing tool to fill the property up. But, and the big one over in by the Lloyd Center filled up quite rapidly. I have not seen any break in the action, but there's a lot of, you know, scuttly butt on the street. One of the scuttlebutt is that there's a major building in Northwest that has been up a little over a year and they're releasing it lower than they were on the new leases. So I would say that it's just a matter of time before that market kind of gets in balance. And I think we're going to continue to see inventory as long as that market remains strong. So I would expect we're not going to see, you know, these rents just running through the roof, and that vacancies will tick up a little bit.
Mark, great. Thank you so very much.
Great, great.
Hey, let's hear it from Mark and Pat. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you.